Men's Room. Today we're going to be talking about developing healthy relationships. I'm happy to have with us today a professor, a teacher, an educator, and a writer, Michael Kaufman. Michael?
Great to be here.
Pleasure to have you. So let's get into this. Tell me a little bit about yourself and kind of what you do.
Well, these days I travel around to university and college campuses. I talk to students, talk to teachers and faculty. Mm-hmm. I talk about gender issues. I talk about relationships between women and men. I talk a lot about issues around violence against women. Mm-hmm. What my focus is, whether it's on campus or in a workplace or working with international organizations, it's about improving the lives of not only women, but of men.
Right.
And it's interesting because as soon as I say to someone, oh yeah, I work on gender issues, they just assume, oh yeah, women. But it's pretty bizarre when you think about it, because that somehow leaves off half of the human equation.
Right.
Because my focus is on guys and ultimately improving our lives as well.
How do you bring that to men in a way that's us?
Because I'm a guy. So I'm a guy talking to other guys.
Right.
I talk about men. I talk about our lives. I talk about the crap that we pretend in front of each other.
Yeah.
Because we are so good at putting on a show. By the time that we are 12, 13, we have all the moves.
Yeah.
We practice them. That's what we were playing with all those years before then. So we have the moves. We know how to stand. And we know how to smoke a cigarette just the right way. We've got it all down. So we've become really good at appearing to each other like real men. Gender, our ideas of manhood, what a real man is, that keeps changing. It's ephemeral. It's like everyone in the society has taken the same drug and is hallucinating the same thing. Oh yeah, I know what a real man is. I know what masculinity is. Those things don't really exist. We're just like sharing this hallucination.
There's no baseline. It's not real.
It's not real.
Huh.
Whatever it is, it becomes a bit of a game. And you have to think, okay, why are guys busy playing a game? Like, why do we need to prove to other guys that we're a real man? And that's pretty bizarre. But, you think about it. In a school, for example, high school.
Right.
And you think, it takes 10 seconds to start a fight. You don't show a guy respect, and then that's it. Mm-hmm. Well, why is that it? Well, because, let's face it, deep down, all of us are pretty damn insecure about living up to the expectations of manhood. Now, this is bizarre, when you think about it, because guys, if you look around the world, we've got more power than women still, in spite of years of feminism and all that.
Absolutely.
Men still make more money. We still control corporations. We still get more attention in the media. We still control politics, religion, on and on. And yet, guys still feel like we'll never live up to the expectations of manhood. And I think the reason why is that from birth, we are taught that to be a man is to be all-powerful, is to show no weaknesses, show no fear, show no pain. We've been taught not to feel what other people are feeling.
Not to feel.
It's strange. Well, when you tell a little boy who's crying because he's hurt, big boys don't cry, or you're not, stop crying, you're okay, or don't act like a baby, or don't act like a girl. We're teaching him that feelings are not okay. Shut down those feelings. Shut down what you're feeling. Don't be aware. If we tell, when the coach tells a player, play through pain, don't be a sissy, don't be a this or that. We're telling boys to deny what they're feeling. And as soon as you deny what you're feeling, you're also cutting yourselves off from what others are feeling. If you spent your life learning to put on a suit of armor, because that's what it's like to be a guy.
Absolutely, you have our shield.
You put on the shield. How close can you get to someone if it's a shield butting into someone else? There's a barrier between you.
Yeah.
So what I do when I speak to guys is I talk about those invisible barriers that get in our way. Ultimately, you cut under all that, and we want to be loved. We want to have connections with other people around us.
Right.
And it constantly amazes me. Recently, I was at a school doing a workshop with football players. And these were big,
manly of men.
They were big guys, they were tough guys, but as soon as we actually had a real discussion, not the fake discussions we're used to having among guys, but a real discussion, It's just, you know, same as any other guy. Deep down, you want to connect up with other people.
Really?
Yeah.
And you found that with a team of dudes.
Oh, totally. It was amazing. Because, I mean, even I, and I do this a lot, I walked in, I thought, oh, wow, they're filling doorways.
Absolutely, yeah.
These are huge, you know, tough-looking, tough-acting guys. But as soon as I said, okay, listen, we can leave all the crap outside. We can just talk man-to-man. We don't have to impress anyone here. And as soon as we do that, as soon as we say, you don't have to pretend, you don't have to act here, then what happens is guys start having a conversation they've been waiting to have for years, which is, how can we be happier? How can we have good relationships? As soon as we provide a chance for guys to have an honest discussion with each other, you know, like we're doing here,
right?
Then we can be human again.
I can't even imagine how you get a room of dudes to drop the doo-doo and drop the shit. Let's go. Let's talk for real. So how do you go about doing that?
You know, one of the things I always do, sometimes when I'm invited, you know, speaking on a campus and not necessarily that small little thing, but like a big room. And you know, you can all see the guys have been dragged there by their girlfriend or been dragged there because, you know, their professor said, oh, you've got to come and hear this talk or right. You know, whatever. And they're all sitting there, you know, they're sitting there leaning back, trying to, you know, get away from me as far as they can. And, you know, scowling, because they just sort of think, I'm going to be crapped on for the next hour. You
right.
know, I don't want to be here.
Right, he's going to yell at me.
I watch those guys, because they're my barometer. And I start telling stories. I tell stories about myself and growing up as a man. I tell stories about the guys I meet all the time. And it becomes clear I'm not there to dump on anyone. I don't believe in collective blame. I don't believe that men are bad. I believe there's some things that some men do that's bad, so let's face up to that as men. I believe that women have been discriminated against. Well, let's face up to that as men. I believe that some men have been discriminated against. Well, let's face up to that as men. So you just talk about that stuff honestly. I tell stories. And I just watch those guys, the ones that have been leaning back, and I watch as they drop their arms, and then they start leaning forward a bit, and then real carefully, so their buddy next to them doesn't see them, they start nodding. Because it's the first time they've ever heard in their whole life another man say, you can never live up to the demands and expectations of manhood. You'll never succeed. And he thought, inside, he was the only guy who felt that. He was the only guy who thought, oh man, I've got to always perform. I've always got to be on top. I've got to get respect. He thought he was the only guy who worried about it that way. And as soon as he hears from someone, another guy, you know, all of us worry about that. None of us are ever going to live up to that. So just let go of it. Man, it's just like, that's what it is.
Heck yeah.
It's like, you don't have to keep performing. You don't have to keep trying. If you want, you know, if you're ever worried about your manhood, it's real easy. You don't have to go beat up someone. You don't have to put someone down. You don't have to prove anything. Just, you know, go into the bathroom, stand in front of the mirror, pull down your pants. You know, if you've got a penis, you're a man. Easy.
And that's it.
That's it.
I'm going to take a break while I go check. No. Yeah. So then where does it come from? Why do we have to play this game then? Where do we learn it? Where does it come from? Why?
That is a great question. You know, I think it comes because we're probably about 8,000 years. You and I are not quite that old,
but probably around
humans,
six, right.
Have lived in male-dominated societies.
Right.
Societies where men have had power.
Mm-hmm.
And we and our ancestors grew up within that. And within that, you develop certain cultures. Certain cultures where people have assumptions about what it means to be a man or what it means to be a woman. Now, women have been rebelling against that. Women, for the last 20, 30 years, have said, enough of that, we're not going to go along with that crap.
Right.
They've set out to do it differently. You know, they said, we don't just have to be passive and weak and, you know, little playthings. We can be weak sometimes and strong other times. We can do whatever guys do.
The role of women has changed. Yeah. Women have been rebelling against this. Yeah. Why haven't men changed?
Yeah.
I don't have to beat my chest. I don't have to kill an elephant anymore or whatever it is and take care of my family that way anymore. So what's kind of happened with our development, if you will?
It's a great question. Actually, I did talk a couple years ago to a guy in Africa who was doing equality work, but also before he got married, he did have to go out and kill a lion. This is totally wild, let me tell you. But I know what you mean. But,
excuse me, guys.
No. It's a moment out from my equality work to go kill a lion. But, you know, I think there's a couple of things. One is that I think guys are changing. One of the big things is when you talk to young fathers or men who are going to be fathers, they're really clear that they want to do it differently than their father or certainly their grandfather did it.
Mm-hmm.
They are much more committed to seeing that being a father as a priority in their life.
Mm-hmm.
Not just spending quality time with their kids, but quantity time.
Right.
Doing their half of the jobs.
Right.
That's one huge change.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
Guys, more and more guys in North American culture are learning to be affectionate with each other. You know, people, you know, there's still discomfort, but you see more guys hugging each other.
We got the half hug down.
You got the half hug down. Yeah, well, that's halfway there.
Yeah, we're halfway there.
Just being relaxed, you know, the way women can be relaxed with each other.
Yeah.
I hear stories all the time about guys who just refuse to go along with some of the crap. I heard a great story just yesterday about some woman telling me about her five-year-old boy, whose favorite color is pink, who got this huge lecture from his grandmother about how he shouldn't like pink, it's not a boy's color, on and on and on. And at the end of his lecture, he crossed his little arms and said, "I still like pink." You know, and so I think, good for you. You know, you don't have to.
Good little guy.
Yeah, exactly. So I think one thing is guys do resist some of those messages, but it's still hard.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard because, first of all, in some cultures, guys still get benefits for being men. You know, if you're a man, particularly a white man, you've had access to the best jobs, you've had access to more money, on and on. Well, it's natural that we're not going to want to let that go.
Right.
Now, I think there's reasons why we should let it go. It's going to be better for our families, better for our daughters, if we have daughters or sisters. But so there's fear of losing out. There's fear that if women gain in status or power, men are going to lose out. You've got to suddenly compete with the other half of humanity.
Right, as opposed to just sharing.
That's right. But there's also fear. There's just plain fear. Remember when I was saying that guys fear, secretly fear. You know, it's hidden, but we fear about that we're not real men, that we're not going to live up to the expectations. Well, if women can do basically anything we can do, if they're as smart as us, if they're as capable as us,
mm-hmm.
and look at, you know, you look at sport, Olympic records, the gap between women and men is narrowing.
Isn't it? Yes.
Now, yeah. You know, and things having to do with strength, there's always going to be a bit of a gap. You know, the elite athletes, the elite male is going to be, you know, be able to lift more and be a bit faster than the elite
sure.
woman. But all the elite females are way stronger and faster than I am. You know, even with my incredible physique and bulk.
You know, and that's hard to believe, though.
So this is a change. So guys who are already insecure about being real men, if women can do basically whatever we can do, then you're thinking, well, boy, what makes me a man? I must not be a man. And then you've got to try even harder. It doesn't work.
We've gotten into the relationship now. How do you keep it healthy? Because, I mean, getting there, you know, everyone's like, oh, I've gotten here. And it's like, wait a minute, this is the work now.
Yeah.
So where do you go from there?
You know, you used a great word. It's miserable on one level, but it's the word, and it's work. There's some work involved. You know, we've got these images from sappy movies and TV shows that it's just, you just do it.
Well, you get the girl and it's over.
It's over. That's right. A lot of slow motion running and
right.
stuff like that. And it's not like that. There is work involved. And, you know, we all say work, you know, work. Well, what does that mean?
Right.
Well, I think we always talk about good communications. The number of times I heard someone says, you just have to have good
communication. Well, yeah.
It's like, okay, so what does that mean? And I think there's several things. One is good relationships require honesty. Now, there's an interesting thing, though, because in any relationship, at the beginning is when you set certain patterns for that relationship. Right? You know,
okay, yeah.
It's hard, you know, you gain to know each other, you set a pattern of how you interact, what you do, how you do it. But of course, at the beginning of a relationship is also when you're most vulnerable. When you're feeling you've got to be most careful, you can't take too
scared,
big risks,
right,
you're scared.
Right.
Real men are never scared.
Other people are scared.
Other people are scared.
We're cautious.
Cautious. So you're scared, but this is actually when it's, in a way, most important. To be honest. Being honest about feelings, about what we like, what we don't like, what we're feeling, what we're thinking, the more we can do it. I'm not saying you can be totally honest, and I'm not saying that people should sit down when they first meet and, you know, start telling their deepest, darkest secrets, you know.
That might be a wee bit of a mistake.
Well, yeah. You know, I've been traumatized ever since I wet my bed when I was in, you know, first grade. You know,
it's like date over.
Yeah, right. So I'm not talking about being stupid, but I'm saying part of a good relationship means taking some risks, being honest. You've got to protect yourself and guard yourself and be aware of dynamics, but it's also taking some chances. Part of it, the work, is around good listening. We all say good communication, and as guys, we think, oh, yeah, I'm a good talker. No. Yeah, you got to be a good talker, but it's also about good listening. As guys, part of our training is to be good talkers, to be in charge, to be in control, to give advice. But we're missing a lot. And what we're often missing is where she's coming from. what she's feeling, what she's thinking. And so that's where the listening comes in, to ask questions. I mean, I can't tell you the number of times I've sat in a restaurant or movie theater, and you could tell someone's on a first date. You know, the girl maybe once in a while, say something, and it's usually asking him a question about himself, but he's just performing,
Right.
You know, just keep thinking. If she's asked me this about myself, I'm going to ask that about herself. If you're interested enough to be with her, you know, find out about her. Here's the hard part. The hard part's not only shutting up for a minute.
Yeah,
the hard part is listening to what she's not saying. Because if someone is a bit nervous, for example, if someone is anxious about something, that may come out not in what she says, but what she doesn't say.
Right.
So, for example, we know from studies that a horrific 20% of women in North America have been sexually assaulted. And that sexual assault, it covers a range of actions, you know, not just rape, but sexual assault, 20%. So that means there's a pretty good chance that someone you're dating may have experienced some form of sexual assault. Now, you don't go out and say, oh, want to get to know you, tell me, like an interviewer, have you ever been assaulted? You know, obviously not.
Right, because that's going to put anybody on their guard.
Absolutely, and be disrespectful and putting her in a place that she shouldn't be. But you've got to know that, perhaps her hesitation around, let's say, in a sexual moment, there might be some history there. There might be religious beliefs that she hasn't felt were cool to express that make her feel or do something or not do something. So you've got to pick up on those moments' hesitation. When I say listen to what she's not saying, you've got to read body language. Is something making her uncomfortable? Is suddenly she's a bit stiffer? Is suddenly she's a bit different? Suddenly is she avoiding me? I'm calling her and she's not calling back. I've got to listen to what's not being said. So good communication is not just about being honest and saying, being brilliant with our lips, but it's being brilliant with our ears and our intuition.
And that's against that's against our whole manhood thing.
You're right.
It's such a hard thing to deprogram.
Yeah.
When I speak and I'm trying to talk to somebody and I don't want to say something because it's embarrassing or, whatever the case, but I'm thinking it, how do I speak? And kind of using that on the flip side and going, okay, well, you're saying this, but, you're thinking because you seem like this. And I think that's work in and of itself.
That's right. It is work.
You know what I mean?
And I like the way you said that. If we're thinking about what we're saying, we're knowing we're trying to communicate different messages. So, man, you look so hot tonight. That might be communicating, I want to be with you, I want to see more of you, tonight, I want to spend the night with you.
Right, but it's hard to say that.
That's right. So messages we all communicate. You can't say it all at once. And if she says, man, I've been so tired this week, she might also be saying, I might be having a great time, but I'm going to be heading home my own bed tonight. So you got to just learn to sort of hear what someone is saying. And that's true, too, even if you've been together for a year, for years. It's that continuing to listen with respect. Part of being a partner is that you're creating equal space for the two people. You're not always in control. That means sharing decision-making. That means not always being in control. That means not dishing out advice to her all the time. Those are all some of the keys. Yeah. And to get help. You got to take a chance. You got to be strong, because guys are worried then. But if we're strong, we can ask for help.
Strength in a different way, and this is one of the things we sometimes miss. But that's such a great point to hit on. Is there anything you'd like to maybe share as a closing thought as we exit the men's room today?
I think what you just said about redefining our strength. We as men can redefine our strength, and the strength is not only all the traditional ways. And I can be strong, absolutely. Strong physically, strong emotionally, strong as a leader. Those are good things. But I can also be strong through respect. I can also be strong by sharing. I can be strong by getting the backup that I need, because we all need some backup. And learn to let go of this pressure to always be on top, always succeed, to be the man doesn't work. And just to be the human being is going to lead us to be both stronger and a lot happier.
Michael, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you for
coming into the men's room and leading us on a nice little men's talk.
All right, guys, let's take a look at our 5 takeaway points from Michael Kaufman. Point number 1, don't deny what you're feeling. We're all insecure about living up to the expectations of manhood. But at the core of all of us, we're looking to be loved and have connection with other people. Be okay with that. It's who you are. Point number two, become a good listener. Get to know where she's coming from. Start by asking her questions that'll teach you something about her. Show a genuine interest for what she has to say and the subtle things that she's not saying. Her body language will tell you everything you need to know. Use your intuition. Point number three, good relationships require honesty from the beginning. Be open with your partner about your feelings, likes, and dislikes. Don't be afraid to take some risks. That's where you'll grow the most. Point number four, as a partner, you need to create equal space for both people to grow. You don't always have to be in control, even if you are the dominant one. Point number five, know that it's okay to ask for help and advice from friends, mentors, and professional services. You're not alone on this journey. And remember, there's no such thing as failures, only opportunities to learn. And in life, class is always in session. I'm your host, Mark Sparks. We'll see you next time in the men's room.